So this meeting, apart from physical meeting, it's also being webcast, and it's being webcast through YouTube. So there are other investors who couldn't make it physically are joining through webcast. Just quickly, I'll take you through the agenda. Can we have the presentation? Yeah. So we will begin with the opening remark by Dr. Goenka. Then we will have presentation from the business leaders, two presentations, one for auto sector, another for FES. Then financial presentation, that will be followed by a financial presentation by Mr. Pathasarthi. Then we will have closing remarks by summing up remarks by Dr. Goenka, and followed by a Q&A. Mr. Anand Mahindra would also be joining in. He will be joining in next few minutes. He would be available for question and answer along with all the senior leaders. And those who are attending through the webcast, there is a window in your screens where you could post your questions, which we will collect it and we will put it to the concerned person. And with that, I hand it over to Dr. Goenka.
Thank you. Welcome to our annual analysts meet. In case you haven't met or seen Sriram before, this is the first time Sriram has introduced, and I welcomed all of you. Sriram has recently taken over from Chandra as head of investor relations. Chandra is sitting there. He will continue with Mahindra Group in advisory capacity. We have with us here several members of our senior management. Mr. Rajiv Dubey, Ullas Yargab, Anish Sa are sitting there. Chandra, Praveen Sa, who has recently retired from his position as President of Automotive Division. Mr. Rajesh Tripathi, Rajan Vadera, Head of Automotive Sector now. Durga, Rajesh Jajarikar, Head of FES. Ashok Sharma, Head of Agriculture Sector. Bharat Musaddi, Arvind Matthew, Rajiv Goel, Hemant Sikka, and Nikhil Matgaonkar are all here, so they will answer all your questions that you might have. I'll just very quickly talk about overall industry performance in FY17, and then my colleagues will talk about performance of Mahindra within the industry, and then Partha will take you through details of financial performance of the company. So this year, the auto industry, in fact the industry as a whole, had a lot of events that caused temporary disruption in the industry. For example, for automotive, we had the situation with NGT ban on diesel vehicle sales in Delhi, which got resolved by August of the of 2016. Soon after that, we had demonetization, and that had an impact for 2 or 3 months on the auto and also on the tractor industry. After that, we had the BS3, BS4 situation that came up, which had an impact on financials of the company, not so much on the sales volume last year. And you will see all of that when we present the financial results. But in spite of all of that, the auto industry in the passenger vehicle segment had the highest ever growth in the last 6 years of 9.2%, and the UVs had now have 25% share in the overall passenger vehicle. The highest share that UVs have had in passenger vehicles. And if you recall, I had been saying for several years now that UVs still have a long ways to go because we were not quite at the global average of UV penetration in the passenger vehicle. Now with 25%, we are pretty much at the top of UV penetration, and therefore we would expect UVs to grow more or less in line with passenger vehicle for for next few years. On the tractor side, was one of the best years that we have had in tractors for some time now. After 2 years of degrowth, we had a healthy growth of 18% in industry, led by because of the very good monsoon that we had, and all, everything else was favorable for the industry. So we will run you through those details, and after the three presentations, I'll come back and give a little bit of a summary, and then we'll get into question and answer. So Rajan, if I could request you to come and start the automotive sector presentation.
Very good evening to all of you. Let me start with a summary presentation. So amongst those growth drivers and the challenges that Pawan stated, if we look at our performance on the utility vehicle side, we can see clearly the pressure. Our two new launches that we made have been slow to take off, and also the competitive intensity in the UV segment is increased multifold. Consequently, we haven't grown there, just about retained the same as last year. The next one is the small commercial vehicle, where we have a growth of about 7.7%, the industry growing around 8.2%, and in the 2 to 3.5 ton segment, we have about 7.7%, and with a growth of 13.5% in the industry, very, very competitive again, it is becoming, and the competition is heating up in that area. In the LCV segment, we have done well. Vis-a-vis a 4% industry growth, our numbers are 18%. And on the M&HCV segment, again, it's negative, and we have about 17.7% growth. The total for the domestic auto sector is at about 2.5%, vis-a-vis an industry of about 6.5%. Moving forward, let me give you more details individually of each of the segments. In the commercial vehicles, we launched Bolero Long, which is a vehicle where the loading capacity goes up. It's almost about 10 inches longer deck, more bigger cabin, short nose, a very comfortable vehicle. And also, we added range in the Supro range of trucks, where we added another 26 horsepower engine, vis-a-vis the 45 horsepower that we had already launched in the Supro Maxi truck. So this completes the range. And the Bolero Long gave us some very decent volumes last year. And it continues to have a pull in the marketplace. In the heavy commercial vehicle, we had our Blazo brand, which we had positioned with a lot of fuel efficiency improvements in the product. And we also gave a fuel efficiency guarantee, we gave a service guarantee. We started a new initiative last year of opening service entire on the entire corridor. So from Delhi to Mumbai, we have almost 14 touch points. Every 70 odd kilometers, there is a service touch point. And this gives us the advantage of providing service to the customer throughout. Is almost run by one single source, and we've also opened parts plazas. Two things that the customer wanted in this segment was a fuel efficiency and service, and we answered both of them. And I'm happy to share with you that we have 40% repeat purchase in Blazo. Blazo as a product, as a brand, is established for its fuel efficiency, and the parts plazas that we opened helped the supply of spare parts. Here again, we have given also a guarantee that on the 150 fast moving spare parts, we'll give it to you when you come to our showroom. If it is not there, it is given to you for free. It will be sent to you if it is not there. Blazo continues. We have almost 34% repeat purchase on that. On the small commercial vehicle, which is less than 2 tons and less between 2 to 3.5 tons, we continue our Super Macy in terms of very good products like Jito, Supro, and the Bolero pickups. We have consistently maintained more than 50% market share there, and we have achieved highest ever volumes in this segment of 166,000 or so in this in the last year. In terms of the range, in this commercial vehicle range, we are coming up with the ICV, which is the range from 7.5 to 16 tons. We are almost there as per the product schedule. And next year, we plan to roll out the 9 and the 12 ton vehicles. Also, P602, which is the on the Jito platform, it's a passenger vehicle, and will get launched this quarter. So our product in this commercial vehicle domain will get complete from a three-wheeler up to 49 tons. I think there's a small error. There is another 49 ton, which is quite a big market in the tractor trailer, which is missing from there. So we'll complete the range with that. Moving over to passenger vehicles. Last year, we responded with the Bolero Power Plus. Bolero Power Plus was our answer for the Bolero volumes that were going down. We added a value proposition of a much better mileage, better maneuverability. We gave enhanced warranty and more power. We put in a 1.5 liter three-cylinder high, more powerful engine. We also responded by putting a hybrid in the Scorpio, which has done about 2,500 units per month. On the other brands like TUV, we are sprucing up the product by customizing two-tone versions, and also we enhance the value to the customer by increasing the horsepower from 80 to 100. And we've already started seeing signs of numbers increasing in the TUV segment and the KUV segment. We will be refreshing the KUV this year. So there is a refresh that will be coming on the KUV Scorpio XUV this year. On the export front, we have done very well. Highest ever exports have happened this year. We have done close to 37,000 exports. This is on drop of some new launches that happened on the KUV, as well as Scorpio pickups that we launched in Taiwan, and KUV launched in Nepal, CKD plant that we opened in Bangladesh added to the volumes. Moving forward, the electric mobility is another area of focus, and I'm happy to share with you that we have grown here. Also, powertrains have matured. We have fully matured saleable powertrains in the area of Supro as well as Verito. We have sold quite a few numbers in this area, and looking forward to doing much better, as you all have noticed recently in Nagpur, where the government interest is increasing. Government commitment is going up in the area of electric vehicles. Even people in shared mobility like Ola are committing themselves to electric vehicle. And we are fully prepared with our powertrains for the electric mobility. In the area of powertrain division, earlier we had plans of, you know, doing $1 billion USD. I'm happy to report that most of the plans are working. In terms of our focus as an organization, we want to move from product cost reach to more solutions and experience. And we want to get into objects of desire in terms of offering the Internet of Things, connected car, and the e-mobility in our products and services. We are going to look at platforms that can be shared for mobility. We are going to provide the customer value proposition in the area of both passenger vehicle as well as commercial vehicle. In the area of passenger vehicles, Live Young, Live Free is our experience that we are talking to the customer about the product and the entire ecosystem of post-product as well as the community. In the area of commercial vehicles, Takdeer Badal De is our value proposition. Again, we have various initiatives of first selling the product, then surrounding it with various service initiatives, followed by the ecosystem of DigiSense, which is all about telematics, infotainment, diagnostics. With this, we feel the value system goes up. There is a huge focus on technologies. We've already getting ready for a Euro 6. We have the experience of doing Euro 6 products. Our XUV is already Euro 6. It will be not very difficult for us to move from Euro 6 to BS 6. technologies are almost similar, software is similar. It's the calibration according to the real world driving condition which will change, which will call for time. So we are quite well positioned. We are also getting fully ready with a range for gasoline engines, CNG engines, and plug-in hybrids. And of course, I talked about electric mobility. On top of that, if hydrogen as a fuel comes in, we have even technology demonstrators to take care of the hydrogen requirements. Crash and safety is being put in for regulatory reasons and also for giving a better value to the customer, including certain advanced driver assist systems that we have already technology ready and being appropriately planned into various platforms which are in the works. Similarly, we recently launched a Technopack on XUV, which is an app that is fully connecting the customer with his phone as well as the entire ecosystem. Digital value chain is going to be our biggest focus forward. We've already done a lot of work when it comes to the virtual development of a product to cut short the cycle time of development and remove one phase of validation and prototyping. We are moving very aggressively in the digital domain in terms of automation and the next level of industry 4.0. On the pre-sales, we are quite well placed in the area of in the social media, and we know the game well, but a lot of work has to happen. There are some initiatives on SUV. In the area of sales, we will be using these diagnostics very well to our advantage. And post-sales, of course, our Vidyu Hamesha has worked very well. We want to strengthen this, and we feel a digital business enterprise is what we are getting ready for. So moving forward, our focus is going to be on enhancing a UV portfolio, which this year we will be coming up with one major new product towards the end of the year, and of course refreshing our current UVs. Our range for the commercial vehicles, as I said, ICVs and the Jito platform based passenger vehicle launch would be there, and we would focus even more on providing value to our customers. The GST implementation is a challenge to be getting ready, that will engage us. Crash and safety norms, which is a regulatory requirement, going to hit from October on all the new models. We are fully ready for it. BS6 emission norms will take a lot of bandwidth. And as I said, building a digital business enterprise is going to be the focus, because that's where the world is moving, and there will be a competitive advantage that we think we must drive. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. I will present the farm equipment sector performance, starting with the industry. As you see, the industry grew, and Pawan mentioned that earlier, 18% during the course of this year, and in the last quarter, which is quarter four, the industry growth was at 13%. If you look at the industry volume over a long period of time from F03 to F17, you will see its bits of volatility, but I think the message here is that the industry has delivered a 9.6% CAGR over a very, very long period of time. While that was the story on the industry, we grew 23% during the course of the year, and in the quarter four, we grew 14%. What that resulted in was our highest ever market share of 42.7%. And we gained 1.8% share points during the course of the last year. If you look at that as a trend, of course, we've been number one for a very long period of time, 34 years. But this curve kind of shows you the uptrend that we've been seeing in our market share and in a way strengthening our position very strongly in the domestic space. I've kind of tried to walk through some of the reasons which has led, or the enablers which have enabled us to get market share growth. Product has been a very integral part of that market share gain story. We launched the UO beginning of last year, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. We also launched a new 42 horsepower product, which is a 742 in Swaraj. And we launched two products in the 50 horsepower range. One is 585 under Mahindra brand and Novo 49.9, both in the same horsepower range, but with very different levels of technology and hence two very different price points. The UVO has been what we would call a blockbuster success. It was a new platform where we launched five products cutting across 70% of the industry, all in one shot. So 32, 35, 40, 42, and 45 horsepower products all got launched in one go. And they've all been very well received by the customers. We recently launched, so that's an F18 launch, a new product, which is a 24 horsepower four-wheel drive product called Jivo. It is a product which is specifically designed for horticulture applications. Horticulture production in India now is actually higher than grain production. And we see this as a very big opportunity where we can enable growth of the category. This is a product with superiority on many factors and is uniquely designed to work in multiple applications. So while it has a vineyard application and will compete with some of the players which are already there, it has a torque which is significantly higher than anyone else in the space, as well as very good fuel efficiency. So it carries all the Mahindra advantages into the horticulture segment, a very robust multi-application product. We just launched it in Maharashtra last month, and we will ramp up and expand over the next few months. Some of the other enablers which have helped us gain market share. One has been customer centricity, building service reach, which is very important, following the strategy of creating doorstep service, which is very important to the farmers, where we send mechanics on bikes to farmers' homes service. We've strengthened our dealer network and channel, and of course, this is a very important success factor in the tractor industry, where each link represents your ability to gain, because you need the reach, and the dealer is your best representation of reach through a very wide rural country that we have. It's not just the number of dealers, but the health of dealers and providing viability to those dealers. And I think we've done that well. We've continued our focus on quality, while of course our quality of our existing products is very good. What is significant is the quality of the new products which we've launched has been first time, right? And that is a very important building block because in the rural farmer segment, the first impressions build the word of mouth, and we have started off with a very, very good word of mouth, both earlier on Novo and then UVO and now with Jivo. The last bullet point may seem like a cliche, which is cost management, but the last 2 years where we saw industry degrowth has made us look more strongly at costs. While it's always been our endeavor to bring costs down, but it has prepared us to handle volatility better. And hence, as you will see from the financials of this year, the improved margins is also a reflection of an improved cost structure and an improved working capital management. Applitrax is our implements business. It grew just 1% this year. It was a bit of a disappointing performance. One of the reasons why we grew only 1% here was the harvester industry didn't have a great growth in F17. It actually, harvester industry went down by 17% in the year F17. We have very aggressive plans to grow our Applitrax business in India and of course our farm machinery business globally. We had a very good year on exports. We grew 26%, and this was our highest ever export number. Mahindra USA revenues grew 8%, and we now are at a very good critical mass with revenues of more than $500 million. We are also a 10% market share in the less than 80 horsepower and the number three player in the North American market. So that was on the short-term performance. Just want to talk a little bit about how we see the future, what kind of innovation and disruptions we see as we move on our journey of going from being a strong domestic tractor player with some exports to being a truly global farm equipment company. There are two critical streams of work. One is the farming 3.0 and the other is globalization. The farming 3.0 is necessitated by the way the needs of food production, food consumption in the world are going to go up. And a lot of that growth is expected to come or is needed to come from improvement in productivity and yields because there's not that much more arable land that's going to get added, which will improve food production. That is going to lead to a use of much greater technology, which will be the drivers of yield and improved productivity to meet needs of food production worldwide. We are working on several projects and initiatives around the three bullet points that you see there: smart farm machinery, precision farming, and digital platforms. The other area of focus for us has been globalization through, of course, inorganic opportunities. I'm going to talk a little bit about them in the next slide. Building a manufacturing footprint, creating a global product development organization, and acquiring brands which enable us to grow in specific markets. So this chart kind of tells you where we are today. And there are three different legends. One green, which talks about product development centers for tractors, farm machinery, or both, where we have a manufacturing or CKD assembly, and the yellow triangle, which is on-ground presence. The on-ground presence means we're not operating through distributor there, but we run the channel ourselves. So the sales marketing responsibility is undertaken by a Mahindra office. This chart does not cover sales that we do in more than 25 countries through distributor networks. So this is really not the export strategy, but the global strategy. The three, four important bullets to talk about are Japan, where we acquired Mitsubishi's agri machinery business. That's close to $500 million business, both in tractors and farm machinery. We believe that those products will enable us to leverage the rice value chain globally, but also build capability for horticulture through lightweight tractors that they have. They are currently primarily a Japan-focused company, and we believe that there is a global opportunity there. We then have also acquired a company in Finland, which is Sampo-Rosenlof. They are a specialist harvester company. We would like to use Sampo in Finland as our center of excellence for development of harvesters. So all our harvester requirements globally, including India, will be developed in Finland for the rest of the world. So that's the second piece of the global product development strategy. The third piece of the global development strategy is Turkey, where we acquired a company recently called Hisarlar, which is the market leader in soil preparation stage of the farming, which is products like rotavators. And we believe that we will build an implements business globally from Turkey. So as you can see that there are several plays. They are all going to be tied in through either market access or product development capability in different parts of the world. We've recently also started our own on-ground presence in Brazil, by acquiring Bremont, who was our distributor there. And we are also creating our own sales and distribution channel through Mexico. Both Brazil and Mexico are being overseen out of our Mahindra North America operations from Houston. They're not necessarily owned by Mahindra USA. Mexico is and Brazil is not. But we have letting the North American or the American view come into business growth and business development there. So that's really the future from the short term, moving from the very top view to where we are in F18. All the indications right now are for a favorable monsoon in the current year, and we hope we will have a good double-digit growth for the industry in the year F18. Thank you.
Once again, on behalf of the entire team at Mahindra, we welcome you to Q4 Analyst and Full Year Analyst Meet. I'm going to be talking about being as on the runway and ready to take off. And this will be in terms of five sections that I will talk about the world, a little bit about the world, a little bit about India, and how does auto and tractor industry look from these. And then about financial results and future rise, and I'll talk a little bit more about it when I get there. Okay, first about the turbulent world that we are in. So when we talk about this turbulent world, I'm reminded that this is a year of exits. Brexit, where you know, UK decided to exit the European Union. It's also an exit of a lot of leaders and a lot of new leaders who come in, whether it's US, UK, France, New Zealand, Brazil, and other countries. It's also a year of exit for partnerships like the TPP. So TPP went out of this and then came, and I hope it will be replaced over a period by something else. But today, trade pact seems to be not the most favorable thing of the season. And the last one is that there is also an exit of people of the old policies, old philosophy of world trade, to be replaced with protectionism and a lot of you know, refugee kind of crisis, and new orders are being defined. So it's a turbulent world that we are in, and it's also in a sense throwing up opportunities even as it throws up challenges. And money is a matter of interest, and interest is a matter of interest. So US interest rates are increasing. It further strengthened. QE is no more, I hope, and interest rates are increasing there. So both put together, there is a little bit of strengthening of there, and hope they are hoping that capital will get attracted towards US based on these actions. On the other hand, there is negative rate of interest in Europe, and there is negative rate of interest in Japan, but Japan slowly is coming back into the growth mode. So as they say, thoda hai, thode ki zarurat hai, is the kind of scenario that you say from the interest point of view in the world. Now coming to India. India has always been colorful and has its own rhythm. And if we say that it has been without its share of issues or problems, then it will be, you know, not saying the whole thing. So whether you look at slower IPP growth, lower utilization of industrial capacities, rising cost of production, muted service sector growth, stressed balance sheets, not just of banks, but also the entire real estate is stressed. Today's newspaper or yesterday's newspaper had that government has to tackle the top 10 or 12, you know, stressed assets. And they ran something like, I read something like 250,000 crores only of the top 10 balance sheet kind of thing. So very stressed. And at this stage, RBI is adopting a very neutral stance. I hope it changes as we go on. But these are some of the difficulties that is there. But having said everything, so they say, even with all the odds, it's a fastest growing economy. So, and they say, as they say in Hindi, jo bhi ho khuda ki kasam la jawab ho. So if you have to see that in the world parlance, where growth is very subdued, it's a very attractive kind of growth, and I would rather be here than any place to see the kind of growth that we see. The bigger positive is the reform push continues here. So, and political stability is another thing that when Narendra Modi and his government saw 3 years completion, and they were, you know, kind of saying both the positives and the challenges that they're facing. So very clearly it comes out that this is something where there is clear will and there is effort to move it in the right direction. And one of the directions is rural focus and faster execution and implementation, which you have seen. Health indicators, all of them, whether it is current account deficit, whether it is the growth rate, whether exports, everything seems to be in the comfort zone today. GST is not when, it is that's decided. How fast will the issues of implementation get resolved is the key question facing us. And last is stronger FIIs inflow and domestic investment is something that we are seeing. Both inflows from domestic is coming in as well as FIIs. So this is the broad thing that we see. Now coming to specific industry in which M&M operates, auto and tractor. Let us see critical factors which affected these two industries. Auto industry, if you see, you know, when you look back and say, auto industry would say, hey, let's look at some other industries and, you know, please also bestow your interest in those industries. Why me only? So if you see whether judicial activism or whether, you know, NGO activism or any of this, this seems to have been concentrated on this industry last year. And whether it is NGT ban or the odd even which was declared, or the short-term implication of demonetization in the year. At the very fag of the end of the year, the BS3 to BS4, all has been very, you know, it's just that as soon as things starts to get even, there is one more thing which came in and kind of upset the rhythm. In October, I think the industry was going back into good growth, came November, demonetization impact. So we saw all of that. And then, if that was not enough in terms of this, there was also the business model changes which are clearly happening. Sharing is a change that clearly has come into place. Also from a customer preference point of view, the line between UE and PV vanishing. And in the immediate future, there is uncertainty about GST implications in the short term, even as the long term seems very clear in terms of benefits. So coming to how are tractors prepping the field, doubling the farmer income by 2022 is a clear signal in terms of the rural focus and the prices increasing, the budget which is focused on rural and investments in infrastructure, which augurs very well for the rural market, and normal monsoons. I just said in the just now that I heard that the onset of monsoon has happened in Kerala and northeast parts of India, so just right on time. So I think it's a good signal that we have, it happened the same day that we are having our analyst presentations. So I hope it's a good omen as well. So, but normal monsoons is forecast. And last but not least, the growth, which was subdued due to demonetization, seems to be back on track. CV, in terms of auto, if you look at the performance, and I won't go into details, but CV is carrying the load, UV is having a little bit of a bumpy ride. So if you see all the greens, all the LCV, whether less than 3 ton, greater than 3 ton, or HCV, in a full year basis, have all seen growths, while the UV and three-wheelers have been kind of, you know, in the yellow zone, low growth. And on the other hand, tractor had a bumper crop. It's been a very good industry growth here. M&M has even grown faster. Highest Q4 market share for the last 5 years and highest yearly market share ever. So that's the two things that have come. So let me go to financial results. First on standalone. And you know, whenever I talk about standalone, it is M&M plus MVML because that gives the comprehensive picture. And volumes have already been, you know, talked about. Tractor grew 15.5%. Auto for the Q4 were lower by 1.8% versus the previous year. Revenue for both put together is 10,612 crores, grew 4.3%. 10,612 is the highest ever quarterly revenue that we have clocked. So in a sense, this is a new milestone that has happened in M&M's history. In terms of EBITDA, at 1237 crores, it's lower by 4.4%, and OPM at 11.7% is 100 bips lower than the previous year. And I will explain a little bit on this. We have had BS3 impact. What does it mean? Is due to the BS3 decision which was pronounced, we have had to have an additional expenditure, we can call it a one-time, in Q4. This has been in the form of either discounts or conversion cost or a cost of variable or cost to bring the goods in and take them back of things that we have sold and what we have in the pipeline. That impact is 171 crores. That impact is built into the EBITDA, which is why you see the degrowth. And I will explain in the next slide, if we remove that, what happens. But carrying on, without touching any figure, PBT before EI and PBT after EI is a growth of 13 or 14% at 780 crores. And PAT after EI, our exceptional item, is 874 crores, a growth of 26%. So overall, just to summarize, top line growth of 4.3, PBT before EI growth, or PAT before EI growth of 13%, and PAT after exceptional item is 26%. Why there is a growth in terms of PAT after EI higher than before EI? We have two businesses roughly in M&M. One is the operating unit and the other one is the investing arm. And sometimes investing arm, we are able to harvest some of this value creation that happens. So which has happened in this quarter as well, and that gives profit, which is why you're seeing the overall PAT at 26%. Now coming back to that slide, earlier I said, what if I were to not have the 171 crores impact of BS3? Then what you'd see is the revenue would have grown at 5%. EBITDA, instead of 1230 odd crores, will be 1408 crores, which will be a growth of 8.8%. And OPM will be at 13.2% versus 12.7 last year, giving a benefit of 0.5%. If you look at a continuing basis, our OPM was better than previous year by 0.5%. And therefore, once again to say, top line 5% growth, EBITDA 9% growth, PBT before EI is 14% growth, and PAT after EI 26% growth. That's broadly the summary for Q4. Segment-wise, auto sector top line grew 1.8%, 7,613 crores is the absolute value of revenue, and at profit at 546 crores, they were lower than previous year, mainly explained by that one item called BS3. Okay. When it comes to tractor, 2,702 crores of revenue, a growth of 18.4% versus previous year, and PBIT at 467 crores grew by even faster clip at 31%. Now for the yearly performance. On a full year basis, tractors grew at 22.8%. And auto sector grew at 2.5%. So both tractors and auto grew, though tractors grew at a much faster pace. Revenue on the back of this at 41,895 crores, or roughly 42,000 crores, grew at 7.7%. EBITDA at 5656 crore grew at 7.8%, slightly faster than revenue. OPM on a full year basis is same as last year, and PBT grew at 13, and PAT grew at 11%, and PAT after exceptional item grew at 16%. So just to pause and summarize, top line grew at 7.7%, EBITDA, our cash profit, grew at 7.8%, PAT grew at 11, and PAT after a year grew at 16%. So whichever parameter you look at, it's a profitable revenue growth which is being reflected here. However, this does not take into account two or three very important events that happened. One is BS3. I talked to you about the 171 crores of BS3 impact which is built. The other one is that in F16 we had Haridwar excise benefits. This year we don't have that benefit. That's another big amount. So if you take both of them together and then say, okay, I'll do apple to apple comparison, the 7.8% EBITDA growth will look more like 20% or 21%. So you can actually bump it up by about 13% because of the one time. So if you add that and then say, okay, there is a third element called demonetization. So we did not get full 12 months of business in F17 as compared to F16. So we can't say whether it is 1 month, half a month, 1.5 months, we can debate. But there is some impact of this. So if you look at that, F17 performance versus F16 becomes that much more credible. So overall, this is the kind of benefits that we had. Okay. Coming to segment on a full year basis, auto sector grew 3.2%, and the segment result were down 17.6%. But again, like I said, if you take the Haridwar benefit and if you take the BS3 impact out, then there will actually be a growth. So when you come to tractors, the top line on a full year basis against the 22% growth in revenue also grew at 23% in terms of revenue growth, in line with the volume growth, and profit at 2,562 grew at 31%, even faster than the revenue growth. Okay, and I know many times I've been asked this question, that is auto margins going down? And I thought, I would kind of answer this question through one slide which is here. If you look at this, this is our normal margin that you see in your segment report, that this is the EBITDA that you AD plus MVML for the past 5 years, F13 to this. It is auto plus trucks division, a trucks business which is incorporated. So if I were to remove the truck business, because earlier truck business was not along with it and it came later point, so what happens is you see that our margin in F13 was 14.1% and today it is 14.5%. So in the last 5 years, our margin, if anything, has improved versus F13. And it has remained in the band of about 14.3 to 15%. So clearly we have managed margins and maintained margins in the auto. Very, very strong margin maintenance in spite of the challenges that you have seen. Okay. Overall, our performance indicator, OPM, we have maintained for the year. ROC has improved to 18.3 and EPS from 55 rupees last year has gone to 63 rupees this year. In terms of financial debt equity, we have net debt is zero. We are in fact negative debt as far as it's concerned, and we have remained that way for some time. And gearing multiple has been very low and continues even to get even better. And as Ashok Sharma points out, I put in, said lower the better. So that kept on. Okay, coming to the bigger picture for the group view. First is that, we have been getting fruits at regular interval. For example, if you take this year, we got between dividend and, share sale amounts coming in, about 900 crores this year. So every year we've been getting regular returns from our subsidiaries. And as you can see, it is going in the right direction as time passes. And some of you may be asking about value creation, so I thought I will kind of share some thought of it, some of this year. Tech Mahindra, we invested 1.44 crores. Today, it's more than 10,000x at 10,579 crores for that figure. MMFSL is a 61 times growth. Mahindra Holidays is 105 times growth and continues to our investment. And some of our new investments, SsangYong at 2x, Mahindra Lifespaces 3x, and EPC Industries at 3x, and so on. So the list can go on, and there are many other value creations that happen, which we will be sharing as things happen. Pawan had pointed out last time that there are some businesses which have $1 billion potential in the medium term, and he talked about some of them. So just to give perspective, Agri Group is separated into a new company, and today they may be about 150, but they have a very quick path to saying $1 billion and value creation over a period of time. Similarly, Mahindra USA, Rajesh Jajrika shared that they are about $500 million right now, and they are again looking towards $1 billion kind of an top line in the business. Mahindra Logistics is another company in the group, about $400 million now, and they're clearly looking at $1 billion over a period of time, medium term. In the future, renewable is the future, and we are also looking at it very strongly. That's another $1 billion bet that we can clearly have. Now let me come to one question that you've asked, and this has been around two things, two-wheelers and retail. And you said, what are we doing about it in terms of what has, MTWL, how is it going, what are we doing, and retail, what are we doing? So we have had a very clear shift in strategy. We are now going from mass player to niche and premium two-wheeler player. And this is done in a way that we have resized and cut our losses in the main entity, and now we are focusing our energy in terms of being a mass player and niche player. So in MTWL, last year was this year, the loss have become half if we do not take one-time cost. Of course, this year we have had one-time cost, which is in terms of restructuring and making one-time corrections. But our continuing loss have been halved. Coming to retail, we have gone into a strategic partnership with FirstCry. We have applied a click plus brick model, and which opens up huge opportunities. You are aware, I talked to you some years back about CIE and auto components of ours, and how a strategic relationship created huge value for all of us, and we hope this happens for the Mahindra Retail as well. Okay. So what does the value creation mean for all of us? If you add all our listed companies' market cap, today it stands at 25.4 billion, and that's a 25x growth in the last 12 years, and the last 22 years it's a 115x growth. Why 12 and 22 is because 2 years back I started showing this slide, which was from F05. I've not changed the original years, and maybe next year you'll see 13 and 14 and so on. So that's how I said, don't change the original year, and keep show how value creation happens over a period of time. Okay, now coming to consolidated results. So this year the consolidated results, 89,700 crores, a growth of 11%. And PAT after all minority interests are removed is a growth of 18%. So even in spite of a tough, challenging environment, the top line of the group went up 11% and the bottom line went up 18%. Within that, I'll now talk about segments. Financial sector, as you are all aware, it's a listed company. You've seen the result. It's been a challenging year because of rural. However, the top line still grew, though because of NPAs and conservative provisioning, our profits are lower at 40%, but the top line did grow. When it comes to automotive sector, you already have explained this season. On a consolidated basis, SsangYong did a profit this year as compared to the previous year, which was a loss. So overall, top line grew 7%, and the bottom line was 6% lower, but it's on the right direction with SsangYong contributing positively. Coming to real estate sector, the top line grew 26%, but the bottom line appears as if it has degrown. But this is because of how IND AS or IFRS treats accounts. there are many units which are our 51% owned companies, which are now being treated as associates. Though PAT has grown 11%, here at PBIT level, it seems like it has degrown. So that's the reason our real estate on the bottom line grew 11% last year. Farm equipment was a strong performance. You already say, I will not add more to it. However, even at a consolidated level, even if globally, our revenue is up 27% and our bottom line is up 32%. Coming to hospitality, the top line grows 43% and the bottom line grows 23%. However, because of the same IFRS, this bottom line is also showing subdued. If you see their group PAT or consolidated PAT of hospitality, the profit after tax is up 71% year on year for that hospitality sector. And last but not least, at two-wheelers, I told the top line is degrown because that's the focus is from mass to niche. But as you can see in the bottom line, the profits are lower, the losses are lower by 21%. And if you knock off one times, then the business in India, actually, the loss went down by 50%. Okay. So in terms of the results over a period of time, the last 25 years, our share price would have gone 49 times at an IRR of 17%. Last 10 years, 3.3 times, and last 5 years, 1.8. All of them higher than the Sensex index, and of course, gold. Last but not least, I just take a minute on to ready to take off and what is the future staring into. I started talking to you about auto and say auto industry may feel like, why me? So, in a sense, the auto sector's answers will be, try me, and what am I doing to continue to hold and innovate, but more importantly, build for the future, is being talked about by Rajan. But to say that from the future point of view, whether it's electric vehicles or introducing the gasoline option in all our products, and if it is a sharing economy which will come, our own efforts in getting into the sharing economy through smart shift and many more that you will hear in future, and focus on a global market and creating a global design and development capability are all our ways of looking at the future. With a lot of hope and lot of optimism. Coming to farm equipment sector, in order to harvest the bumper crop that could be in the offing because of all the positive energies, we need to build future. And Rajesh talked about globalization, which is new market, whether around Brazil, Mexico, Turkey, or Japan. And enlarging the product domain, and what new tools like precision farming or innovation in motion, whether driverless tractors or artificial intelligence into tractors. So again, here we're looking from this. And Mahindra is a micro sim of various business model. You have the rural play with not only M&M but agribusiness and Mahindra rural housing, and the services play with the Tech Mahindra, Mahindra Holidays, Mahindra Finance, the Make in India drive coming through, and some enablers for economic growth, and disruptive business model, whether in terms of first choice, or bio agency in Tech Mahindra, or rural housing, and emerging industries in terms of healthcare and Mahindra Solar. So with many ways, we will look at how we can look at rural focus and different business models at the same time. When we look at the future, we have to kind of see three things. The first one is, how do we look at globalization? Second is, how do we bring technology and innovation to bear in everything that we do? And third one is, how do we put customer at the center of the whole place, a customer first theory? And when we put all this together, then what we have is looking at tomorrow and delivering tomorrow's future through all this. And that, I think, is what we want to do in order to make Mahindra globally admired brand. Thank you.
Thank you, Partha. So I hope you have internalized all the numbers that Partha has thrown at you. You will not be allowed to leave this room till you pass the quiz. That will be distributed very, very shortly to you. Just asking you to ensure that you have understood everything. Let me just take a few minutes to kind of summarize a few things that have been spoken by my colleagues. First, I just want to talk about the word futurize. You have seen that in the presentations made by all three presenters. It is not changing Mahindra Rise to Mahindra Futurize. It is about reminding ourselves that the future in the industries that we are in is going to be very different than the present. And as we work on here and now, we are also keeping tab of what we need to do to stay ahead in this industry, each of the industries that we are in the future. Whether we talk automotive industry, whether we talk tractor industry, whether we talk IT industry, whether even we talk finance industry. 5 years from now, these industries will look very different, and Futurize is all about keeping our eyes open for that. Very quickly, Rajesh had talked about two things, farming 3.0 and globalization. And I hope globalization part is very clear to you, because the acquisitions that we have done, though small in nature, are all part of a larger puzzle that we are fitting pieces in and creating a whole that would make Mahindra truly global in terms of our farm equipment business, not just tractor, but farm equipment, including other farm machinery. Farming 3.0 perhaps is a little bit more difficult to see right now, because we just started on some of the elements that Ardis has talked about. Precision farming, we believe, is going to be a very big change in the way farming is done in India. And we definitely want to be the enablers of precision farming in India and bringing to India for small farms what is happening today for large farms. And therefore, it's a very, very important focus that we're putting in redefining Indian agriculture through Farming 3.0. Some of you were there for the roundtable that we had with the analyst a couple of months ago, where we had talked about that in more detail. Rajan talked about future of mobility and or mobility play, as he called it. In a way, we are envisioning the future of mobility and what we are doing in various things, whether it is partnering with Ola, because we think that in future the ride sharing is going to become a very predominant mode of transport, or whether we get into electric vehicle and put in disproportionate amount of investment compared to the kind of business that we have today, but again, envisioning the future. Smart cities, the way we're looking at that. Driverless cars, the way we look at that, though we are not doing any active work on driverless cars right now. But that's futurized in automotive space is all about looking at these things and getting ourselves ready for that. So while you're looking at future, of course, we have to manage here and now. And here and now is no cakewalk for any of the businesses that we are in. I think Rajesh has taken you through all the reasons that we think that we would have continued good performance in tractor industry and farm equipment industry this year. We have a very good set of products, both for Mahindra and for Swaraj, and we'll be launching more, especially in Swaraj, we'll be launching a new platform this year. And therefore, I think that we are very well set for continuing the kind of performance that we have seen in the last year into the current year. And as we have talked about, that we see the industry growing reasonably well because of the good monsoon and the positive sentiments that we see going into the industry. On the auto side, one question that you will definitely ask is about the UV volume or UV market share. So let me get that out of the way even before somebody asks that. Yes, indeed, our UV market share has been dropping, and we have talked about that in the past, that as more and more players come in, the leader will have a lower market share than what we had when we were only three or four players. Having said that, we do admit that market share is lower than what we would like to see at this point of time. But you should also take a look at overall industry. And the UV market share does not become the only indicator. If you look at the total industry growth last year, it was 6.5%, and our growth was 2.5%. So what we are losing in UV, we are making up to some extent somewhere else. But that does not mean that we will not want to work very hard to increase the market share in UV. This year, that will be the largest focus for us, and we think that with the product changes and improvement that we have done to a couple of products that haven't performed very well, and the new products and refreshes that will launch during this year, we definitely should see an increase in market share in UVs during the year. I think when it doesn't get highlighted, but over the last 4 or 5 years, or 6 years, we have increased our market share in small commercial vehicle from 30% to 51%. So 51% of small commercial vehicle market belongs to Mahindra today. This year we will have the safety norms coming in. We are well prepared for it, not an iota of concern that we have. We will have the BS6 norms coming in 2020. Again, we are well on track on that, unless of course there is an intervention and something changes, then we don't know, but based on the current announced plan, we are well on our way to do that. Just coming to what Partha talked about, a couple of points I want to highlight. First, in the previous year's result, we had to keep in mind that the 530 crore and the 170 crore is a hit that we had to take on our operating profit. And in spite of taking 700 crore hit on the operating profit, we have managed the operating margin. Of course, tractor performance helped the auto performance, but overall, we have managed the margin in spite of taking 700 crore hit on our operating profit. And Partha has also talked about looking at Mahindra and Mahindra as two companies, one the operating company and one the investing company. And he has talked about how the investing company is giving us returns by view of dividend and also by view of readjusting a portfolio, which you have seen in the slide that he presented. And that will keep happening now that we have a good portfolio of investments. Many of these companies have matured, where now we have the flexibility to play with it to see how we maximize our return on the investments that we have done done in the past. He also talked about shifting strategy in some of the businesses that have not done well. He gave you example of the two-wheeler business and the retail business. Also, some time ago, we had done Systec, as you are well aware. So pivoting our businesses to different business model is something that we are now very comfortable with. Systec, as you have seen from the share prices of our ownership of CIE and Mahindra CIE, has given us very good dividend, and now we will see how the retail does and how the new strategy that we have for two-wheeler does, which we had talked about in great detail about a year ago. So I stop there. I request Rajan and Rajesh to join us here on the dais for any question answer that you may have. And Mr. Mahindra will, of course, join in answering all the questions.
This is Pramod from Goldman Sachs. Anand, the question is for you. This side, Anand. This side, right. Yeah. You guys have talked about the pain in the UV side in terms of the increasing competition, and we have seen some other players also re-looking at the India strategy. So I'm just, given the amount of capital what we invested over the years in this business, and despite that we have seen market share slipping, and there's some massive changes on the macro front in terms of technology, emission, fuel economy norms for 2022. Given all that, is there a rethink on the business in terms of whether we could collaborate and then focus more on the farm equipment business, which incidentally takes only 1/4 the capital but gives more than half the EBIT of the standalone level? And the opportunity, as you mentioned, on the global scale is pretty large. Precision farming, autonomous tractors, a lot. So is there something which you can expect in terms of the way you look at the business from 5 years point of view and the capital allocation thereafter?
Yeah, I guess I... In some form or the other, I always get this kind of question, Pramod, what I call an existential question, you know, should a business exist? And frankly, if I used your algorithm of the simple mathematical capital, return on capital, you know, we'd probably be only in one business today, a business which at that point in time appeared to be giving you the highest returns, you know. 3 years ago, there was a lot of negativism about tractors. And the advantage of age, my age I'm referring to now, is that I've gone through so many cycles where at every point in time, there's somebody telling me to get out of some business or the other. You know? Tractors at one point in time, I go back, way back when it was not exactly seen as a high growth business. We thought our penetration had peaked. And people said that you're going to die because Sonalika is going to overtake you, a Swaraj tractor is going to overtake you. You know where Swaraj is now. So I'm just saying that, you know, entrepreneurship is not about algorithms. That's what investors do. That's for something you guys to do. You can make your investments and decide allocations and capital. We build businesses. We create the options for you guys to invest in. So if you look at the slide that Partha came in at the end, you can either call it a mess and say, why are these guys into everything? Or you can look at it as a wonderful thali of food. You know, we are providers of thalis. We are not the people who are the deciding exactly what the highest return is on bondas or is it on bhelpuri. You know, we are giving you the thali. India is a thali. That's what entrepreneurs get joy out of. You know, if you sat in front of Elon Musk today and asked him the return on capital on SpaceX, what do you think he's going to tell you? Is Tesla still giving you a return on capital? Look at its market cap. I mean, so the world has changed. Now, all I would beseech you to do, promoters, support entrepreneurs, okay? And support entrepreneurs who are not stubborn beyond a point. That's the point Pawan was making earlier about our businesses. You have to look at when we know when to pivot, to use his phrase. I've been through many questions about CIE, sitting here with all of you. And I think I would appeal to you to give us some credit that even when we pivot on a business, we do so and create value. Some people just say, shut the door. That's how a fund works. That's how a PE fund works. 7 years are up, down comes a drawbridge. It gives jollies to some people, doesn't give jollies to us. We are builders, we are entrepreneurs, we like to create value. So I think if you look at CIE and the value it's created, that was another business people were telling us to, you know, apply euthanasia to some time ago. And if you look at First Cry, I don't know whether Zubin is here, what we were doing might have sounded like we were just going down the road and just beating a dead horse, but then we looked and understood that, and I've said this openly in public quarters, that in the e-commerce business, consolidation is going to happen. Eventually, you're going to have to be both click and brick, and you're going to be the dominant player. There's going to be a huge consolidation. And if you look back at our strategy there, we took over Baby Oye. And then when we found that First Cry was really somebody we didn't think we should be competing with, but collaborating with, we are now actually the largest shareholder in it. And it is the only player in the field. And you're going to get good news about that too, because when somebody becomes the only player, it's a very different ball game. So there'll be value creation there too. But if you went by your algorithm, we should have shut down First Cry or whatever it was, Mum and Me, a long time ago. So patience, persistence, conviction, not stubbornness. That's all I would tell you we'd want to do. So I think as far as the auto business is concerned, I've said this many times, and there are people in this room who've heard this story. I joined in 91. I was told shut down the auto business by a very venerable firm of consultants who, you're the new avatar of, but they told me the same thing. They said, just stick with tractors. And then you see, you know, in 2002, somebody told me, you're dead, Toyota's, I know, Qualis had come. No, it started when I came in, I think it was Gypsy first is going to kill you. Then it was Sumo's going to kill you. Then it was Qualis was going to kill you. We've had so many assassins out there.
We haven't killed many times.
What's that for you? I see dead people. Isn't it that film, Sixth Sense? I see dead people. That's what you're looking at. You should be looking at us and say, I see dead people. These are people who were meant to be dead a long time ago. We still go on. Thoda sa value usko de do na, resilience ke liye. And persistence.
On that note, I get a point on the entrepreneurship, but is there a need for change or as a group, are you open for collaboration?
That's a different question. Now, let's talk about collaboration. Look back at our history. We've always collaborated. In fact, I remember with Mahindra and Mahindra started with collaboration, with Willys, with International Harvester, with the McCormick family. In fact, I used to joke with my uncle Keshav that we seem to be better at being good partners than being better businessmen, really. And that wasn't great when I came in, that most of our time we were spent in thinking we were great partners, but that was in the pre-liberalization era, when the partner had no choice but had to stay with you. So I think we've built over time, we've become the people want to partner with. I think that's also a matter of satisfaction. Why would you look for collaboration? We are always open. We have it in our DNA. We constantly do it. All over the world. One of the investments we made was in Mitsubishi, which is still an active partner. We constantly partner and we use partnerships to grow. We did it with Renault, we did it with Peugeot, we did it with Ford. So we'll be open to any kind of collaboration that comes in. But the fact is that we have to be somebody who is defining our future. We are not investors who are either passive PE investors or partners who just say, we are bogeys to your engine. We'd like to be the engine. But we'll be open to collaboration. And coming to your last question, again, I can talk all day on that, and I won't, I promise you. That's the right question. What are you going to do about the auto business? How is it changing? And I think Pawan talked about it, Partha talked about it, Rajan can go on about it also if you like. We understand very clearly that things are going to change. But I'm going to go back to a very simple principle we outlined when we launched the TUV. We see the business morphing into a field where ride sharing will be a very dominant part of mobility and the commodity end. We have got very major bets in that area, and bets which are beyond what you even see here. When you look at what we've done, we've invested in scoot networks in the two-wheeler electric, which are using ours. Postmates in New York has started using our Mahindra Gen Zs. And arguably, two-wheeler electric vehicles will have an equal share in mobility in urban areas than cars. So there's a huge growth opportunity nobody's even looking at in the ride-sharing business, where we've taken a stake. So are we open, forget to collaboration, are we open to new ideas? Tony Seba just made news, right? About talking about how everything's going to be electric in 5 years. It went viral, his thing. Well, guess what? He spoke to us in Chandigarh. We got him over in December at our annual leadership conference. He gave the identical speech. It just went viral now. So in a sense, we are accustomed to hearing people talking about doom and gloom and telling us about the new future, and we'll adapt. So sorry for that overly passionate reply, but I'm sorry I keep getting this question, so I enjoy answering it, frankly.
Hi, it's Ashish Nigam from Axis Capital. I just wanted your thoughts on GST and the rates. It's sort of contradictory to what, I mean, the fact that SUVs are cheaper and hybrids are more expensive, it just contradicts the government's earlier likes and dislikes. So how are you all reading it? Is there more clarity you all are waiting for? And is there any pricing action we can expect in the GST rollout?
So, see, what had happened is you need to go back in the history few years before understanding what has been done. If you recall, there used to be only two excise rates. There was a small car excise rate and a large car excise rate. And artificially, by using certain criteria, the excise rate for large cars gotten increased twice, another 3%, another 3%, to make three different slabs there. Siam had represented to the ministry at that time also that this classification that has been done is very artificial, and this is making the excise rate go very, very high. Okay. What was told to us was that, yes, we understand that, and it will get rationalized at the time of GST. So all that they have done is rationalize at the time of GST to make a rate for large cars and make a rate for small cars. Okay. And that's the way it used to be 3 years ago. And there's an additional cess that they've added for diesel and petrol for the small car to keep the duty same as before. So in effect, we are back to that two GST rate situation. And I think that is consistent with what the government has been saying lately, because they have said very clearly that we should not be distinguishing based on diesel petrol. And other than one exception, that is what they have done now.
No, so with hybrids at least, is it something which is a roadmap for what happens in 2030 where they want to go all electric? Do they want to discourage hybrids right now and encourage you to go straight to electric?
So, in a way, the first signal that hybrid benefit may be removed came when FAME benefit on hybrid was removed about 3 months ago. After April 1st, when the new FAME scheme came, the hybrid benefit was removed. And from that, we are extrapolating that perhaps there is a rethinking in government of India on what should be supported as a future technology. And if I was to read between the lines, based on the GST rates that have been announced, clearly that's the direction that is being defined, that we need to focus as a country on electric vehicles fully. Therefore, electric GST has been kept same as what it was in the excise regime. And the hybrid benefit has been removed. And that's what appears to be the direction. Having said that, there has been a representation by SIAM to GST Council that abrupt change in hybrid sort of taxes is sort of killing a future technology. And it has been said that GST Council, when they meet next week or this week, later this week, will take a re-look at it to see whether that should be redefined, the hybrid definition. But right now, that's the conclusion that we can draw.
Hi, sir. This is Kapil from Nomura, right at the back.
Yep.
I just wanted, if you could share some more details about the electric vehicles, both in terms of product launches as well as what technology you are looking at. We have heard some news about electric three-wheelers, or I don't know if it's e-rickshaw, and whether it will be lithium-ion technology completely that we will look at,
okay,
or lead-acid technology also figures somewhere in that. And along with that, something on capacity. And related to the previous question, is more for the Indian industry as a whole, do you think we will straight away migrate to EVs, or do you think there is a roadmap in terms of moving to hybrids and then to EVs?
Okay. Are there any other questions on EV and hybrid? Then maybe we can take all of them together because there will be similar questions. Does anyone else have a question on EV or hybrid? Yeah. On EV and hybrid. Can, if you have a different question, because I think he has asked almost everything.
Yeah, so
if you have a different question on EV and hybrid, please come in and then I'll try and answer all together.
Just on the new GST rates that have been announced in terms of 28% for small cars and 43% and the 12% for electric vehicles. So now, given the current cost structure for the EV, do you think, how competitive do you think EV is now under the GST regime?
Okay, any other question?
Yeah, this is Vivek from JM Financial. It's a slightly related question. Do we see that the product portfolio completely change with the coming of EVs, because generally we have seen globally cars like Nissan Leaf or Chevy Volt, which are passenger cars and not utility vehicles. So does the EV push entail a completely different product portfolio?
Thanks. In Mahindra context, you're saying?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Any other question?
Yeah. And how critical is the EV strategy for the 2022 fuel economy norms for you as a company?
Okay.
Yeah, one question from me also.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. There are about 75 people on the, you know, watching this through the web, and they are also feeding live questions in. So thank you, you know, and welcome to this analyst conference. I'm taking one which is related, which has come from Pramod Amte, CIMB, and he's asking, please, can you tell me about the EV product launch pipeline in the next 2 to 3 years?
Okay. All right, so let me try and...
Just one more, Jay Kale from Milara Capital. On your kind of capital allocation going forward for EVs, and what is the kind of break-even that you all would be having going forward? And since you all are the kind of have the first mover advantages, what are the key learnings that you all have had in the last few years which could give you a competitive advantage in this space going forward?
Sure. Okay, so I will take a few minutes to kind of put out our EV strategy and roadmap for you and try and answer all the questions that have been asked. So first of all, Mahindra has always believed, and that's the reason we had acquired REVA, that there is future for electric vehicles. We perhaps were somewhat ahead of time because we came in at a time when nobody else thought took EV seriously, and we struggled for what, 6 years, 7 years, to get any kind of reasonable business out of electric vehicles. We have in the meantime launched 3 or 4 products, but we have nothing much to show for it in terms of sales volume that we're getting. We are still, even today, getting a total of 100 vehicles per month sales volume from the 4 products that we have launched. But we have never given up on EVs because we continue to believe that there is a very strong strategic reason why India should put its bet on EVs, because Indian cities cannot afford to have the kind of air quality that we have today, and because India cannot continue to import a lot of crude oil to feed into its diesel and petrol vehicle. And finally, I think that same realization has come in the regulators or the decision makers in the government of India, though we have been talking to them for quite some time, and there's a very, very clear push from government of India now to say that EV is the future. Okay, the GST thing that we just talked about perhaps is one more indication of that being done. And right now, Government of India has come up with very aggressive roadmap that has been announced by Niti Aayog, which was made public about 10 days ago, on 3 phases of how we're going to go to an all-electric fleet, all-electric sales by 2032. Now, the way I would like to look at this 2032 all-electric is what we call BHAG. BHAG is a big, hairy, audacious goal. Okay, that doesn't necessarily mean that you have to achieve 100% electric by 2032, but it's putting something that looks almost impossible ahead of you as a plan. And I must appreciate what Government of India is doing by putting that in. Even if you don't get 100%, even if you get 25%, even if you get 15%, you'd have made a huge difference in terms of the impact it will have on the environment, impact it will have on our import bill for crude oil. So I'm not even looking at 100%. We are saying, let it be something reasonable. Let it be 10%, 15%, 20%, and let's plan accordingly. Okay. So that's one part. Second part is that up to now, India, Mahindra is the only sort of serious player in electric vehicles in India. In the four-wheeler, there are some three-wheeler players. But as the volume grows, there will be more and more players. So just like UVs were left alone to two or three players for a long time, everybody came in. Same thing will happen here. So Mahindra is not moving forward with a view that we will remain a monopolistic EV manufacturer in India for a long time. In fact, it might all change in 12 months, where you will see six, seven, eight other people come in. So we have to look at current portfolio, we have to look at current technology that's going into our products, and we have to look at future portfolio and future technology. And the work that we are doing is keeping in mind the two sort of parallel tracks that Anand talked about, the object of desire and object of mobility. Electric vehicles will definitely separate out itself out in object of mobility, which will be the kind of products that we have today, which will be used by the Olas of the world to move people from point A to point B. And our job is to give the right kind of range to go from 110, 140 kilometer to 200 kilometer, keeping the cost very affordable so that it makes commercial sense for Mahindra and for the aggregator, the fleet operator, to use it, and make the vehicle comfortable so that people who are using it do not feel that they are compromising by going into electric vehicles. So that's one track of work that we are doing on technology as well as products. Second track is that we need to have high-end electric vehicles, which will be 360 volt, 300 and 400 volt kind of battery, which will go 0 to 100 in 5 seconds, which will give you a range of 350 kilometers on one charge, but will cost you a lot more. Those will be the objects of desire that we'll be creating, and that work has already started in our own R&D center in Bangalore. And we would expect to launch those products in 2 to 3 years' time frame. And we have talked about the Pininfarina product, where we are currently in the process of designing, not designing, finalizing on what the product would look like and putting everything in place to make that happen. And that, of course, will be a very large investment. Other thing that we need to worry about than technology and product is capacity. Right now, we have a meager capacity of 400 vehicles in a month because the demand is only 100 vehicles a month. Now, we can keep waiting for demand to happen, but if demand happens and capacity is not there, demand is going to go away. So we have to also plan for a capacity, and we have made a decision, taking a bit of a leap of faith, to invest in capacity to go from 400 to 1,000 in phase one and from 1,000 to 5,000 per month in phase two. You may say 5,000 per month, how can you talk about when you're selling less than 100? But 5,000 per month is less than 10% of what Mahindra will be selling at that point of time. And therefore, it's not a large volume at all. And if we are not selling 5,000 electric vehicles 2 to 3 years from now, then we are not serious about electric vehicles. So I do believe that that kind of volume will happen with everything that's happening with the government and with everything that's happening with the aggregators. Question on cost structure and whether it's affordable. Right now, with the current level of incentive that is given by Government of India and the state government through farmers scheme, through GST benefit, and through state benefits, we are just about right with no margin for either OEM or for the aggregator in running this as a taxi. Just about right, okay? We need to improve our cost, and I have given a number of 20% improvement that we need in cost, which is very much in the realm of possibility, because the battery costs are coming down, which is one third of the cost of electric vehicles. And therefore, we are targeting a 20% cost reduction over the next 2 to 3 years. And once we get there, we will definitely have a very affordable electric vehicle, at least for taxi application. And for personal mobility, the cost have to come down further because the running is not that high, and therefore the payback does not happen as quickly as it will happen in the commercial application of electric vehicles. So I think I've kind of covered all the questions. Sorry for a long answer, but since there are many hands going up, I thought I'll cover everything in one. After that, let's move on to a different topic. If we have time, we'll come back to electric vehicle later.
Yeah, hi, good evening. My name is Gurpreet. I represent Quest Investment. I have three quick questions. One, is there any internal thought on platform rationalization going on right now? Second, what sort of timelines you would ascribe for the two-wheeler segment break-even across levels? Third, SsangYong, if you can give some illustration with respect to the growth trajectory and any geopolitical disruptions you foresee right now. Thank you.
You take first.
Yeah. The first question on the platform rationalization. The BS6 implementation per se will force platform rationalization. So there is a plan in place whereby some platforms will get rationalized, and we have put a very, very big integrated plan where some platforms will continue, some will not continue, based on the economic viability of that platform and also the techno-commercial feasibility. At the moment, a single cylinder engine is under threat. It does not have the, there is no technical possibility to reach those levels. So that at the moment is under threat, but something is getting worked out. Beyond that, there is a new platform that will come that will automatically be in sync with our SsangYong. We are going to have common platforms there. You must have heard about Tivoli being a common platform. Similarly, moving forward, we will have some common platforms. So that's the way it will get rationalized.
On SsangYong, you must be aware that we have just launched the G4 Rexton. It started selling towards the end of April, so about a month of sales. That product has been received as well as Tivoli was received when we launched that product over 2 years ago. In fact, this month we'll be selling 2,500 of those. And at that price point, 2,500 is a very large volume for SsangYong in that product. So we are hoping that that SsangYong's success will give us the second sort of spurt in demand for SsangYong. Tivoli continues to do well. Having said that, there is a little bit of headwind happening right now in overseas markets, whether it's China, a little bit more geopolitical, but more to do with SsangYong being a little late coming in China, and we're still working on it. Russia, Iran, Western Europe, all of these markets, we're having a little difficulty in volumes. Therefore, export volume is down for the time being. But we think it will recover that from third quarter of the calendar year. Domestic volumes are doing fine. And since we have just launched G4 Extend and not started exporting it, we think from third quarter onwards, both domestic and exports should be all right. Okay. Anything else?
Two-wheelers. Two-wheeler. What is the question?
Yeah. Question was, when is it breaking even?
When is two-wheeler breaking even?
You want me to answer that? Okay. Two parts to this. First thing is that let's talk about MTWL. Yeah, or Mahindra Two Wheelers Limited, that's the company which was operating. Last year, loss has already been halved, that I talked to you about, on two fronts, reorganizing and cutting people cost. Now, the next step that we are doing is merging that into M&M. So the process is on right now, and it may take some time, but the merger is what is on the cards. When we merge it into M&M, we will be able to utilize many of the fixed costs across various things. So it should even further decrease the break-even point. So, and we hope that in the next year and a half, we are in a break-even kind of position on that front. So that's on the Mahindra Two Wheelers Limited. Having said that, there is also another thing which you, and some of you asked about, you know, the other setup that we are coming, which is the Classic Legends or the new organization where we're going niche. So there the product launch, when, you know, will happen in the next 2 years time frame, and that's the kind of time frame they're looking at hitting the road running. So broadly, that's the two. But this, the major part is to Mahindra Two Wheelers, and that's through merger and reduction, we will be very, very low in terms of whatever cost we incur on that.
Hi, this is Amin from Deutsche Bank. I think you have announced that you will be spending something like 12,000 crores in capex and investments over the next 3 years, which is a significant increase over the 7,500 ballpark that you had for some time. So is the increase mainly on account of the investments in EVs, or are there other areas where you are foreseeing a significant jump in investments?
Yeah, broadly two portions. Till now, we had talked about 10,000 crores, not 7.5, okay, to be fair. 7.5 was always the capex, and 2,500 was the investment. So these are two portions. Now what we are saying is that 10, you know, even with inflation, it increases by something. So it's 12,000 instead of 10,000. So that's broadly. And like I said, if you take 4,000 a year, roughly the breakup is 2,500 crores for capex, which still is the broad 7,500 in 3 years. And the investment is more like 4,500 crores over a period, reflecting a little bit of globalizing effect, both in investment in organic and inorganic in small ones. Of course, nothing here in says a big M&A is part of this, but that's broadly the two focus. So it's not big change, it's small change, but we are reflecting the fact that there is more investment which is coming. So,
and just one more thing on the farm segment. You're doing a lot of things to obviously have revenues coming in, not just from tractor sales. But even today, I think whenever we talk about the sector, whether it's from outside the company or inside the company, one of the first 2-3 points is whether monsoon is going to be good this year or not. So what do you foresee, in how many years would you be able to sort of de-risk yourself from the monsoon and the vagaries of the monsoon so that, I mean, that is not the first one or two things that have to be kept in mind while looking at the revenue growth of the business.
Yeah, please.
So just to set the record right, it was the last thing I spoke about in my presentation, not the first one or two things. We are looking at de-risking ourselves from domestic market as a key part of our strategy. So we have shared publicly that we are targeting 50% global revenue by 2019. So that's what we're working towards. Right now that figure is in the range of 30-35% plus. So that is a consideration when we look at our de-risking strategy. Adding on farm machinery as a new business vertical is a part of a de-risking strategy, and of course it will be an important part of the global strategy. Farm machinery, when we look at as a global industry, is about $150 billion, and tractors is $55 billion out of that. So there is a very large global farm machinery industry that we can address. Obviously, we don't want to address all of that and play everywhere. So we are clear in which segments and what farms, land size holdings we want to address. So the point I'm making is India is 6 out of $155 billion market size. And we do see ourselves playing in that large size. And I think maybe in 3 years' time, the conversation will go beyond what's happening to India monsoons.
Just to add on to that question, the question you asked was an interesting one. It's a question for India, not for Mahindra. When are we de-risking ourselves in the monsoon? You know, we've been asking that since independence, I think. So the question really is that I think we are already, in a very non-visible way, getting independent from the monsoon. There have been a lot of collective efforts from various NGOs, government quarters, which are beginning to pay off. Irrigation percentages have gone up dramatically. It used to be only Punjab, if you remember, in the old days. So the irrigation percentage has gone up. Our investment in EPC, in a way, is actually joining the two and being part of the solution rather than asking the question. So, but apart from irrigation, Rajesh mentioned horticulture. There's a very different kind of usage pattern of water there, and a much more advanced method of harvesting. Those who are doing horticulture are given to more scientific farming practices. So they automatically become a little resistant to the monsoon. And in a broader sense, I think the rural economy itself, some time ago, I think it was what, 7-8 years ago, and Rama pointed out in a seminal article that the rural economy had gone away from agricultural income to non-agricultural income was the bigger part of it. So as services grow, you'll see the rural economy again distancing itself from the monsoon. Now you might say that doesn't affect tractors, but I'm just saying as a rural economy, if India keeps generating demand and building resilience, you will have more resilience even in farmers there because they will have diversified incomes. and will be able to buy even when, despite having one bad year. So I'm very hopeful on that front. I actually think India is getting much more risk insulated from the monsoon.
Can I also just put in and ask one more question from the questions which have come from the people who are watching this and participating. This is on to, I suppose, to Rajan. Rajan, they're asking is, while the CV industry is facing such pressures, how could M&M manage a good positive growth in FY17? I promise I didn't write this question.
Sorry, I didn't hear the last.
Yeah, he's saying, while the CV industry is facing so much pressure, how could M&M manage such a good growth and a positive growth in FY17?
Okay.
I thought we had to defend if we don't do well, not defend if we do well.
Okay. So, I think we have to go a little bit back about a year and a half when we created value for the customer. And the biggest value in the HCV for the customer is fuel efficiency and service availability. We had the lineage of a product where we designed it for overload considerations, but over a period of time, the overload practice disappeared practically. So our vehicle was tough, it had higher horsepower to cater to the overload requirements and faster turnaround. But once that practice disappeared, nobody was looking forward to overloading the truck. And hence, we had to lose about 600 kg of weight on the truck and also use our fuel smart technology that we had developed in the auto domain, where through the one fuel pump, we could develop three fuel ratings of 170 horsepower, 200 horsepower and 240 horsepower. And we gave that choice to the driver. Depending on when the truck is loaded, overloaded or on a gradient, he could press the switch and get the fuel map moving, the torque moving. In this entire process, we also brought in our calibration knowledge of the electronic engine, which Mahindra has had the fortune of using for last 10 years, the CRD experience. So we use that CRD experience, the calibration experience, to make our truck most fuel efficient. In the process, when we started the measurement, we were getting much better fuel efficiency. So we also got it independently tested from independent agencies. Having done that and having that disruptive value in the product, we decided there's no point in rolling it out just like that. We went for a very disruptive, very bold campaign where we used Ajay Devgan to say, if you can have a truck which is more fuel efficient than Blizzo, please return me the truck. And with that campaign and the value that we demonstrated also, the first two trips were being driven by our drivers and the fleet owners got the comfort. And consequent to that, we established this Blizzo product. And Blizzo was a fixed price product. Customers started buying it. We have about 34% repeat purchase on this. So with Blizzo, we also wanted to get rid of the red color, because some driver would say, well, red color wala truck jo hai, wo hum nahin lenge. So we made a turquoise. We changed a few, made some styling changes. And I think we have had good success. Moving forward, we have completed the range from 25 tons to 49 tons. So that's the way it went about.
Yes, sir. Chirag here from Edelweiss. Oh, yeah, center.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So two questions I have. One on this inorganic activity. So from here on, how should we look at that? If you look at last 8 years, we have bought under-invested businesses. Then we moved to acquiring significant majorities in various businesses. From here on, how should we look at your inorganic activity? What things you are focusing on, given the way environment is changing around or the changing at a faster pace? And the second question was on the UV part of the business. How are you keeping yourself abreast of changing customer preferences? We missed, in a sense, or we were late in identifying this shift of customers to lightweight crossovers or SUVs, which are pure five-seaters. So while we may be trying to put a foot in that category, suddenly a new category will emerge, our preference may change. So how do I look at these two parts?
You want to answer that question? No,
So, very on that first one, Chirag, you are aware that we've always used very cautiously any approach on inorganic that we have taken. And we have had broadly very good success with it. So at the end of it, I keep saying this, that we have invested everything and our debt equity ratio is zero. So we've kind of invested what within very well within our means, and none of them are very big bets that we have taken, which we can choose. And the bigger ones have been Punjab Tractor, SsangYong, and Satyam, yeah, all of which you know, and some auto components which we have talked about. So in the past, that's the kind of bet. In the future, each sector kind of looks at what bets. So you heard from Rajesh, the bets around globalization. So we have had three or four acquisition, which is Mitsubishi, Mahindra Agriculture Machinery, the Sampo, Hisar Lal in Turkey, etc. And in auto, you've not heard anything, but there are collaborations and there are opportunity. Similarly, other sectors we look at inorganic. Listed companies, by and large, take care of themselves. They don't look to M&M. And the other companies which are unlisted may look. And we would very much kind of look at the same kind of value creation framework that we have used. Okay. So to kind of summarize, the past has been a very calibrated, inorganic, based on strategy and based on financial return. The future will be of a similar nature.
So we may still evaluate some under-invested businesses where technology may be an issue or ownership may be an issue. That kind of opportunities we may still evaluate.
Yeah, I didn't understand the question exactly, Chirag. What is the crux of your question inorganic?
Yeah, so
I wanted to understand that.
So what I was trying, if you look at SsangYong, if you look at two-wheeler businesses or even Punjab Tractors, these were businesses which were not necessarily well invested before you acquired them. So you had put in a lot of effort in terms of management, in terms of cash flows, and now what we see the fruits of those businesses. Do we have the same approach going ahead? Because if you look at last 20 years, the previous decade to that, you had a different strategy of your inorganic activities. In last decade, we have a different strategy of inorganic things that we did. Are we still focusing on similar strategy where we may buy businesses which are under-invested and we may support them to get the technological advantage or the benefits?
Yeah, just a generic answer to that, one which I've always used is people always ask us, what is your plan for inorganic? And I always tell them that the surest way to suicide is to have a budget or a plan for inorganic. Because then you go out and buy things because you felt that you had to buy X to fulfill a budget. Any inorganic activity has to be a subset of strategy, as Partha said. So what is it we are trying to achieve? And then we'll go out and look to inorganic to fulfill that strategy. Whether it's a gap in technology, a gap in a geographical positioning, a gap in branding. So we will continue to look for those. And then the second part is, will we look for underinvested opportunities? Yes, I think we are notorious for actually looking only at good value acquisitions. It's historically proven that when you pay over the top for an acquisition, you normally don't get a good return. So I think if we are answering your question properly, it's not as if there's going to be a change in the next few years. Inorganic will always supplement strategy. It'll be one instrument of strategy. And secondly, we will always look for places where there are opportunities for a turnaround, either because of underinvestment in management or in capital. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, yes. And the second question on the customer preferences. Customer
on UV side. Change. Okay, that question gets asked every analyst meet and press meet. Two-part answer. First is that we did not miss the trend. The trend happened a year sooner than what we had planned. And this I had admitted 2-3 years ago also. KUV 100 work was started long before those products came in, those kind of products came in the market, except it just happened a year sooner. And second reason the question still is coming up is because KUV 100 has not done as well as we had thought. If today we were selling 5,000 to 7,000 of those vehicles per month, you will not be asking that question. So it is not so much about not seeing the trend, it's about the product that we launched not working as well as we thought it would work.
So the focus right now is how do we get KV100 to give the volume that it deserves to give. Rajan had talked a little bit about what we are doing to that product. And we think that we will have a very good value proposition for this product in this year with the changes that we have already done. There are one or two other product gaps that we are trying to fill, because for SUV or for the UV segment, we definitely want to be end-to-end player with a product at each price point and a product for each customer sub-segment in the UV. So there is one more product launch that's happening this year to fill one sort of sub-segment gap that we see, and one product launch happening next financial year to fill another sub-segment gap that we see. Once we have done that, I think we have completely taken care of UV portfolio. Our UVs are not necessarily a cut-paste of somebody else's UV. We have our own sort of plan on what we want to do in UV, what kind of products we want to launch. And we have had many successes, few failures on the way. And we hope that the plans that we have in place will give us the kind of volume and the market share growth that we talked about earlier today.
I just want to add something to that. And this is a theory, and you know, your view, Pawan, if you differ with that. But when you look at the success of a product in India, yes, initially it is always about the lure of the product itself. But if you look at the number of products that have come in and been seeming killers in the market, and then how they taper off, a lot of those are products belonging to companies that do not have the kind of ecosystem and presence we do. But if you take a look at M&M's blockbusters, just take a look at their longevity. We launched the Scorpio in 2002. It is still a blockbuster product in 2016. There are very few companies in India that can deliver that longevity. I don't want to take names, but I'm saying you really have to look at the top three players who've established that kind of ecosystem and have the capability to deliver that. What that also means is I believe it gives us the capability to even if something doesn't seem to hit the target right away, to gradually build our market share. And I think Rajan and Pawan can talk more on that, but the TUV itself is a unique product. Nobody has a product like that except Jeep in terms of its looks and brand and lineage. And I think you'll see us being able to gradually crawl back in, because people trust the brand, people trust the ecosystem, the network, the sales, so on and so forth. So I think, you know, never give up on a Mahindra product. I think we have time, we have much more time than anyone else to get it right. Whereas many other products where, again, we were told we would be dead, those products don't actually dominate the market as they did at launch. And again, I don't want to take names, but I'm sure you'll be able to understand which products I'm referring to.
And just to reinforce the point that Anand made, I'll give you two examples. When we launched Scorpio in 2002, everybody said Bolero is dead. And in fact, Bolero almost died. It sort of went to almost few hundred sales per month. And then we were able to revive that product, and that product became our big sort of volume product for many, many years. And it still continues to be giving us 6,000-7,000 volume last year. And the second one was XUV500, became a very successful product for us, but it had also almost a brush with death in between. And the volume had dropped to almost 1,500 a month. And then again, we were able to revive that product. So in our case, same thing we're doing right now. With TUV, started very strong, it dropped to a low number, now it's picking up again. KUV started very strong, dropped to a low number, it's picking up again.
Sir, this is Vivek from GM Financial. Thank you for the opportunity again. So you took a very good example of, you know, Indian Thali. My question is exactly on that. You know, we have passenger vehicles, commercial vehicles, tractors, and now there's an overarching scheme of electric vehicles, connected cars. How do you look at R&D adequacy and R&D cost? What has been the ramp up in the number of engineers? Thank you.
That's.
Yeah. So in fact, what I just told you, where we could make Blazo a success, came from a knowledge that we horizontally deployed from PV background of Scorpio into the truck using the engine calibration and the fuel smart technology. So, I think we have a very unique place. In a way, I would say we are blessed because our R&D capabilities are from, let's say, three-wheeler right up to the truck, the most advanced SUVs and cars. Consequent to all this, our ability to deploy technology and also our agility to move people across is very good. This comes to us as an advantage. In Mahindra Electric, we are able to develop powertrains, which is the motor battery controller. Then packaging, application, validation and testing of a car is a knowledge that goes from MRV to Mahindra Electric. A very good combination of electric powertrain development and vehicle development that happens. Moving forward, there are engineers that move from commercial vehicle to passenger vehicle to electric. So talent, we are able to rotate. We also taken advantage of the fact that earlier in the truck business, we had a different design styling. Now our styling is all consolidated from styling for agri packs to tractors to trucks to everything. So it's all integrated. It actually gives us economies of scale, cost benefits. So I would say it is a blessing for us to have a common R&D setup. The other part of your question on the engineers, I think in the last 6-7 years, we've graduated from about 1,000 people to today about 2,500 people at MRB. We have 180 engineers in Mahindra North America Technical Center in Detroit. We have people in Pininfarina, which are obviously not captive, but as good as captive, they are also 500 plus. Then we have Mahindra Graphic Research Design, organization that does body and trim engineering, which also have another 60 highly trained people. Then at SsangYong, we have close to 500 plus people in R&D. And we are a kind of an organization which are highly networked, and we can use the technology to each other's advantage.
And just want to add that there are many examples of where we have cross-deployed technology. A lot of the tractor technology that we have put into the newer tractors have come from auto. Mm-hmm. Some of the two-wheeler technology that we put in, we were first in the market, though the product didn't do as well as we were hoping, came from auto experience. Many years ago, before AFS was formed, when we were talking about MRV and talking about SSU, Anand used to talk about, I don't know if he did in Analyst Meet, the horizontals and the verticals. So these horizontals, which is purchase organization, which is the R&D organization, international operations, really provide us a lot of benefit in terms of cross-deploying learning from one business to other business without compromising with the focus on the business. And I think this is one of the strengths that we have in the structure, the way we are organized, which allows us to do both the horizontal and vertical without compromising either.
And the gentleman sitting right in front of you just sent me a mail by the Ruzbe who's there, because he wanted us to remind you, since he runs Formula E, that Formula E is in fact another big laboratory and node in our R&D network, and is going to have a huge bearing on how we sort of insert high-end technology into our cars.
And you might also add that those of you who don't follow, right now we're in the best position that we have ever been in 3 years in Formula E.
Third in the series. But, you know, Dr. Ashok Ganguly, some of you may remember him, he used to head Levers here. He was on our board, and he, in fact, used to head our R&D committee, and he wrote a book, I think, in fact, where he coined this
business
phrase
oriented.
Of defining R&D as a neural network. He says, don't think of R&D as one Fort Knox, one location where everything comes out as the old American companies used to have. You have to go global, and you have to build nodes in a network. We just interact with each other, which is what Rajan described.
Sir, the last part was the R&D cost.
R&D cost.
Cost of?
R&D.
R&D cost.
In what way?
Percentage of net sales. How do you see it moving up?
Yeah, so our percentage spend in R&D is at the global level about 4.5%. 4.5 in auto, and tractor is about 2%. Tractor is about 2% of revenue. 4.5% will compare with any global global player, but keep in mind that we are very small in terms of total revenue. So the 4.5% in Indian, in our context, will be a much smaller amount than it will be for large multinational. But because of our frugal engineering, we are able to still do many products with that amount of money, still meet all the regulation, technological advances that we are doing, which you would have seen in Rajan's presentation earlier. You want to read some of these questions?
Okay. So before any of you, is there somebody who wanted to ask a question? Can I take the question and then come to you?
Yeah, why don't you take a couple of these?
So one question is around from Govindrajan Chellappa from Jefferies. What proportion of our UE sales is hybrid, and how does the higher GST rate impact the business? And second part is, what models are in pipeline in the UE business over the next 2 years?
You answer the first one.
So on the hybrid, we have about 2,500 of Scorpio hybrids that we sell every month.
So that's the only hybrid product that we have. The question on GST rate, I think we have already talked about, that all our product that are sub 4 meter, including and all the commercial vehicle product, come in the 28% plus 1% or 28% or 28% plus 3% category, which is no different than what it is today. So it's identical rate. For the Verito kind of product, again, it will be almost the same excise duty as it is today. The only product where there will be a reduction will be about 3%, we think, will be for the larger SUV with larger engine. About 3% reduction will happen there. And the only product where there's an increase in price is the Scorpio Hybrid, where the duty goes to, tax goes to 43% from an effective tax of about 28% pre-excise. So there's a 15% increase in GST rate for Scorpio Hybrid.
Yeah, good evening. This is Rakesh from BNP Paribas. My first
Good time to go out and buy a Scorpio Hybrid. The prices will go up after 30th June.
Yeah, my first question was for Mr. Mahindra. Based on your interaction with government and your own assessment, do you see government coming out and pushing Indian auto demand in coming future? The context of this question is some of the foreign countries we have seen promoting auto demand by slashing tax rates or something. Within India also, we have seen telecom policies or IT policies driving the industry. So do you see Indian auto demand being pushed by government initiative? And second question was for Dr. Goenka on SsangYong strategy. So in SsangYong, we have been slow in reaching US, especially missing out the recent SUV demand surge. And how do you see that we capturing that? And is there any play from Mahindra standalone business in that progress?
Is there any what?
Mahindra's play in that expansion, reaching out to US from SsangYong.
Very quickly on the government, it has been a frustrating time in the last decade, to be honest, of not seeing the Indian government recognize the multiplier effect of the auto industry. You go into the in America, ever, you know, they've always looked at Detroit as being the engine of America, if you will. So that kind of view hadn't caught on here. I have to say that in the last year, and I can't divulge any names or sources or anything, all I can tell you, there's been a major shift and a major recognition of how the automotive industry can be a very strong engine of growth and of Make in India. So I'll just leave it at that. I'm saying that we are seeing very encouraging signs of recognition of the role this industry can play as a kind of generator of growth.
On the SsangYong US entry, there is not that much new to say beyond what we have already talked about. We are right now still in the project phase. There are teams that are seriously working on the sort of crunching through the numbers to see whether it makes business sense for us. We will go in US only if the Excel seats work, not otherwise. So we and as you know very well, that US is a very difficult market. We have to invest a lot of money in marketing. You cannot go there half-hearted. So we will have to do all of those things before we can come to a conclusion. Of course, if this happens, it will be supported by Mahindra through its board process, through the board process that we are on. Mr. Rajiv Dubey is on the board of Mahindra, of SsangYong, and SsangYong board is looking at very seriously and spending a lot of time to decide whether it is right for SsangYong to invest in USA.
Partha,
you want to
read a question?
Yeah. Hi, this is Sonal Gupta from UBS. Just a question back on the Thali portion, because I mean, if you really look at it over the last 2-3 years, the difference between the consolidated profit after tax and the standalone profit after tax is very small. So is the, I mean, while your top line doubles on a consolidated basis, you're not really seeing much of a return coming out of the other parts. So essentially, it seems to be extremely dependent on the parent. And how do we see this changing over the next few years?
I'll let the Thali part be finally answered by Anand, but at least let me put you the mechanics of the financial construction. So if you look at M&M's revenue and M&M's profit, and then you look at the profit after tax, which I showed today, which is after minority interest. It is not apple to apple comparison. I'm here, I'm talking about PAT, and there is no minority interest removal, but when I'm showing the consolidated, I'm removing all the minority interest. So through that, it's a technical point. But coming back to the second portion, what happens is it's convenience consolidation in a sense. I actually am thinking, we internally do it, and maybe at some point I can start sharing. Assuming every company is a subsidiary, what will be the consolidated picture look like? Yeah, so if I were to add Tech Mahindra's profit as well, yeah, because I don't. Today, honestly, I add a proportion of it after taking minority interest at a line. So this is one of the reasons. The second portion, that's exactly the entrepreneurial nature of this company, that we have a combination of things which are ready to kind of give returns and are the cash cows, are stars. There are some which are emerging, and there are some new businesses which we kind of plant every time. So that is a loss making today, but can be future stars. When you combine all these things together, maybe the equation at the end of the day today seems like a net, zero answer. But you have to remember those were the ones like Mahindra Finance and Tech Mahindra of the last decade, which are stars today, and those investments that we are doing today will be the ones which will be stars tomorrow. So this except the technical, this is the other part of it. So our Thali, therefore, in a sense, gives roti and, not only for today, but tomorrow and day after. So. The other one is in terms of just look at from a point of view of where we started about market cap. Today I showed you that the overall market cap for the group's turnover is about 24.5 billion. And over 12 years back, the same market cap of this entire ecosystem, over 12 years grew by 25 times, and about 100 odd times if you take 22 years, which is from 12 years and 22 years is the two comparisons that I had given. So from that point of view also, if you see that over a period of time, value creation is very much happened in these entities. Okay. So
this I still remember the first stock option that we were given, that was at 28 rupees share. And that 28 rupees is today 1200 and whatever, 1300 and something.
On the consolidated question, I think just adding to what Partha said, you have to probably look at the other investments we made sometimes with a PE way of valuing it, as opposed to looking at what is the consolidated result. Look at the value creation there. And that I think Partha shared in a slide,
yeah,
right? So maybe we can get that slide back up if we can. But as he said, part of it, when you purely look at the legal consolidation, you're going to miss out on Tech Mahindra. You're going to miss out on what the CIE valuation is, because that's not really included in our results anymore. But there's been enormous value creation in CIE. So when you look at the non-Mahindra, non-auto and farm sector picture, try and put a PE hat and look at the investment versus the current market value. That would give you an idea of why we are still very satisfied with the performance, unlike the statement you said where it's implied that there was a lackluster performance there. Is that the one? You can put this on?
Yeah. Can you just beam it on the main screen, what we have on the front? Okay. So in the meantime, as it comes on and we get back to that question, can I ask one question? And this is from Pramod Amte, again, CIMB. And Pawan, his question is, Government of India is doubling farmer income. I suppose he's saying he's taking efforts to double farmer income. Which segment Mahindra sees a big opportunity?
Which segment of Mahindra business?
Which segments do you see big opportunity?
Clearly, we ourselves, which we look at farming 3.0, though it was not in the slide today, I think. One of the deliverable of Farming 3.0 is how do we participate in Government of India's very, very good goal of doubling farmers' income in by 2022, I think they talk about now. 2022, Rajesh? Yeah, 2022. We have within our farm equipment segment and within agriculture sector, Ashok is here, you can talk to him later on, have a lot of things that we have put in place on how we can contribute to that. Clearly, that will also give us business return, but we are also looking at it from a viewpoint of being partnered with Government of India in meeting the very positive objective of doubling farm income in 5 years, 6 years' time. We will take two more questions. It is 7:26.
Yeah. So before you start, let's kind of close loop. This is the slide that we are talking about, and I hope the answer is clear that, you know, this is the point I was making. If we look at the market cap of the entire ecosystem as 6,500 crores in FO5, today it's 164,000 crores. So that's the kind of value creation that you've seen happen. And today my investments, which is a book at about 10,000 crores, market value of that investment is 40,000 crores, which in a sense is the 30,000 crores profit, which is sitting, but I can't. It's a cost base of accounting, but market base accounting would see that kind of market cap increase. Yeah. So we can now go to the next question.
Thank you, sir, for the opportunity. Raghunandan here from Quant Capital. Some queries on the 4Q results. The BS3 related expense was about 1.7 billion. So just wanted to understand in the coming quarters whether any more BS3 related expenses for retrofitting or conversion cost would be taken, first one. Second question was, other income was on the higher side in the fourth quarter. So it was at 3 billion compared to 1 billion YOY and QOQ. Third question was, employee cost in the fourth quarter was lower compared to the first three quarters, and that has been the trend for last 3 years. So any seasonality there? And last question was, there was an exceptional item.
When I said
item.
Two questions, I didn't mean four questions by one person. Okay, go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So last question was, there was an exceptional item. So if you can explain what was the investments which were liquidated, which led to that exceptional income. Thank you, sir.
Can you answer briefly because we are late?
So two out of four I have noted down. The other two you'll have to help when it
happens. One Rajesh will answer. The market share.
Market share, okay. So market share of?
I think you asked tractor market share, why it was low in fourth quarter. Is that what you asked?
No, sir.
Employee cost.
Employee cost. Why it was low in fourth quarter. That also then Partha will answer.
Okay. And three.
We pay less to our employees in fourth quarter.
Yeah.
That's all.
So what? Yeah. The okay. 3 billion question. I will have to come back. I mean, I didn't fully, you know, was not able to fully understand that question. But let's come to first BS3. You said 1.7 million. So I just wanted to make sure I've communicated properly. The total impact of BS3 was 171 crores. 171 crores are 17-10 million. Okay. So whichever. Way it works. The first is that it's broken into three parts. One is the discounts that we have offered on sales or which needs to be offered in future for the sales. The second is the conversion cost, which will happen whenever we bring this, convert this from BS3 to BS4. And the third one is cost surrounding, cost in other costs, which is logistic and other cost which is required to bring it and take it back to the point of sale. So in a sense, 171 is our estimate on a conservative basis which will require to take care of the entire problem of BS3. So, and as was said earlier, it's possible that we may get some benefit later because we may not have to incur all this cost. Yeah, but to our mind, we are not carrying a single penny of problem forward. So everything is accounted. So I hope this is the last we talk from a cost point of view. We can talk about benefits possibly if we are able to save a few dollars. So that's on BS3. Second, exceptional income. I talked about in exceptional income, our portfolio, which is the investment, Mahindra Holidays, I sold some shares in Q4, made a profit. That minus the impairment provision is the 90 crores you see in the exceptional item, which is giving the leg up. The third one is employee cost. Employee cost is helping us because actuarial valuation on the retirement benefits and leave is actually giving us a benefit. And you're right, I mean, and I must commend you, it's happened in the last 3 years, it's not happened before that every time we have come in, it's a function of rate, of interest and various other things. So they are playing positive for us. But you also would have seen that our last year benefit on actuarial was much higher than this year. Therefore, year on year comparison, our growth in personal cost is about 18%. Yeah. Even though there has been. So these are the two parts. The fourth one. These are the three I remember. The fourth one,
can you repeat, please?
Yes, sir. The other income was higher at 3 billion compared to 1 billion YOY and QOQ.
Yeah, okay. Understood. Other income. Yeah. So there is this other income is option valuation, option cost valuation. We have some options. And now under IFRS or Ind AS, every quarter you have to value it. Now whatever options or derivatives that we have, the market value is much higher and that's the benefit of 190 crores that we get. So that's the major part of the difference in other income.
Okay, one more question. Last question.
Hi. This Thank is Bharat Chet from Quest. This is a question for Mr. Mahindra. So with relate to Mr. Partha's answer, that in consolidated numbers, some of the business that we are investing heavily and which is not contributing the profit and which we believe it's a star. So just can you tell us, I mean, which are the star business that we are investing which can, I mean, in your belief can give much higher return tomorrow?
I have a standard answer to this question also. It's called ki agar koi aap se puchega ki aapke bachcho mein se kaun sa star hai, to aap kya jawab denge? You know, and I'm just only partially lighthearted. I never say this is a star, because the moment you say that one is not. You know, so to us, everything, at least in my mind, and I'm sorry, that's my makeup. Everything is a potential star, until proven dramatically wrong. So I really think that when we go into businesses, we don't go in unless we think these businesses can be stars. And Partha talked; he divided them into categories. If you remember that one slide of his. That last one where he talked about you've got disruptive businesses, we've got new age businesses. So all of them have different potentials, but we have picked them because we think they're all going to be stars and big value creators.
Sir, my question was, I mean, which is currently not...
Can you just speak into the mic, I think?
Hello?
Yeah, sorry.
My question that currently which is not making the loss or not contributing to the bottom line, but which you believe that will start over a couple of years.
All of them. If I didn't have that belief, you should fire me for having invested them anyway. I'm not saying all of them will work out. As I mentioned in my answer to Pramod right in the beginning, you can trust us to be persistent, to have conviction, to pivot, but not to be stubborn. We will get out if there is no other option. But as of now, every business we are in because we believe it has a tremendous future. And the same goes for two-wheelers. Look, you could just say, why don't you wind that up in Mahindra two-wheelers? But we went out because we believed that what we should have been doing and what we should now rectify is be in the branded niche premium two-wheeler business, which is why we acquired the brands of BSA, Java and Yezdi. I need hardly tell you what success in those brands could entail in terms of market cap. You just have to look at some of the other role models in that space around us. So that's what we are after. Would that be a star? Yes, that's why we are sticking to it.
Okay, thank you very much. Very interesting questions. Please join us outside for, is it high tea or is it dinner? Dinner, okay, dinner it is.